time and for some time to unmute my microphone, but it didn't work. I think maybe the admin forgot to give me permission, and then also I wasn't able to share the file. Anyway, alhamdulillah, now we are here, and I think most of our brothers, sisters, they didn't join early because last week we said we'll start at 1:15 because of the Salah. But it seems that the announcement that we received, I think it was only 1 o'clock. Anyway, alhamdulillah that we are here. And inshallah, by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we'll start our class, which is about tafsir, as you know. And today we'll start from ayah number 105 of Surah Al-Baqarah, as we already, alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alamin, finish ayat, which is before. And this ayah, Allah Azza wa Jal said in the Quran, مَا يَوَدُّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا مِنْ أَهْلِ الْكِتَابِ وَلَا الْمُشْرِكِينَ أَنْ يُنَزَّلَ عَلَيْكُمْ مِنْ خَيْرٍ مِنْ رَبِّكُمْ الله يختص برحمته من يشاء والله ذو الفضل العظيم. The disbelievers from the people of the book and the polytheists would not want you to receive any blessing from your Lord, but Allah selects whoever He wills for His mercy, and Allah is the Lord of the infinite bounty. We'll go, inshallah, over this ayat as we do always, word by word or ayah by ayah. Allah Azza wa Jalla started this ayah by saying, مَا يَوَدُّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا. The disbelievers. Disbelievers, this include anyone who don't believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Anyone who doesn't believe in Allah, either doesn't believe in his existence, like the atheist, or doesn't believe in his oneness, like the pagan or those who have make partners with Allah, like Christians, or they don't believe in the one that Allah, the revelation that Allah sent to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and this include anyone. Doesn't matter if he is from among the people of the book, or pagan, or atheist, or all those considered as disbelievers. This is why Allah Azza wa Jal confirm here from the people of the book. From the people of the book. This is very clear ayah which say that those people of the book, which mean Jew or Christian, who didn't believe in Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam are considered as disbelievers. Considered as disbeliever. There is no compromise in this. To say, yeah, you are a believer, you are a Muslim, or there's no difference between you and a Muslim, that's not right. The truth is, the only believer is the one who believes in all the prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As we said, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent Jesus Christ, before Jesus Christ, those who follow Musa alayhi salam considered as disbelievers. When Jesus Christ was sent with the gospel, some of the Jew accepted him and believed in him. Those now, the only believers. Those who say that no, will stick to the Torah or to follow the teaching of Moses alone, you are not going to accept Jesus, then they will be considered as disbelievers because they rejected Isa alayhi salam, who was sent by Allah Azza wa Jalla. And Isa alayhi salam, Jesus Christ, when he came, in fact, he came with modification with the law of the Torah. And therefore, we say that the one among the people of the book, Christian or Jew, who doesn't believe in Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, considered as disbeliever, and this fact should be very clear. And then Allah Azza wa Jal said, and the politicians. So there is no difference. The one who doesn't believe in Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, doesn't matter if he was a Christian, Jew, atheist, whatever way he follow, as long as he doesn't follow Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is not, will not consider as disbeliever. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, those disbelievers, no matter what type they are, no matter what sect they are, no matter what religions, other religions, false religion they follow, all of them in agreement in one matter, which doesn't, they don't like or love any goodness for the Muslim. Why? Because they rejected Islam. So how do you expect them to love Muslim or intend good for them or goodness for them? It doesn't mean we expect, you know, we said all of them are bad in dealing, but we hear the Quran is make it very clear that, and this is most of them who doesn't believe in Allah Azza wa Jal or his messenger, they don't intend any goodness for the Muslim. This is why Allah Azza wa Jal said, could not want you to receive any blessing from Allah. ما يود الذين كفروا من أهل الكتاب أن ينزل عليكم من خير. So they rejected the revelation. Why? Because they don't like this goodness, this revelation, this mercy that come from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala come to you. There is Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They don't, and the coming of Prophet Muhammad alayhi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the greatest blessing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave to all humanity. As Allah Azza wa Jalla said, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. We didn't send you but as a mercy for the whole world. Those who disbelieve, in fact, they rejected this mercy. And they don't like this mercy. They don't like us to accept it. This is why they always argue with us about religion. They, you know, initiate or they cast many doubts about our belief, or, you know, accuse Islam and Muslim in different ways. Why? Because they don't like this goodness, this mercy that Allah Azza wa Jal sent to us, this blessing to come to us. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, it's not for them to like or dislike. The one who give or take, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So even they don't want this for you, they don't love for this, don't worry. It's not in their hand. It's not in the hand of anyone to stop any goodness that Allah Azza wa Jal want to send it to you. Any blessing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala want to give it to you, no one can stop it. As on the other side, nobody can protect you if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala want, you know, to cause you to go in trials or in punishment. Because at last, everything is in the hand of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this gives us relief. And also give the Muslim relief, even in the individual basis, that he should not spend his time in fear that maybe other people, they hurt him, they, you know, stop something good that may come to him. And this, my dear brothers and sisters, to encourage us always to strengthen our relation with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Turn to him always in our need. Because if Allah Azza wa Jal wants to bless you, nobody can stop this blessing. It's very important for the Muslim to connect his heart with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah is the Lord of infinite bounty. No limit for the bounty of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. From this ayah, we learn some lessons, confirming the existence of the enmity of all disbelievers against Muslims, no matter, as we said, what way they follow. They are Hindu, they are Buddhist, they are Christian, Jew, atheist, all of them. You see? They, in fact, because they are choose to be an enemy, as an enemy of Allah. They didn't accept his message or his revelation. So the Muslim doesn't mean that, you know, we don't have friendship, we don't deal with them. No. We're not talking about individual basis. We talk about in general. In general, as you see nowadays, look to the troubles that happened in many in the Muslim communities. Who is behind these troubles? You will find those disbelievers, they create many troubles for the Muslim. Make separation among them, make fitna. So the Muslim should be aware that he should not just, you know, follow their plan or just deal with them blindly. He should be wise and smart and intelligent. And this is what this ayat is teaching us. Muslims should be careful and cautious when they deal with the disbelievers. As we say, we deal with them. If they respect, we respect their choice. That doesn't mean we are unjust with them. The Muslim should be just, even with his enemy. He should be just. Treat them justly. Deal with them kindly, nicely. But at the same time, you should be careful. You should be careful. Because in their heart, in their mind, they don't intend any good for the Muslim, in general speaking. The disbelievers try hard to use all means to stop Muslims from making any progress and advancement. And just look and read the history. History. Look what the disbelievers, nations, what they did throughout the history, through the crusader, through many way like occupation for Muslim countries, separated Muslim to scatter them. So what for? Because they don't want the Muslim to have any power or progress. They want them always to be under their control. And this is the reality that the Quran is open eyes for it, that we should be very careful when we know dealing with their plan. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, it is and this is also we learned from, it is forbidden to give those disbelievers authority or leadership in any field in a way that it could hurt the Muslim or the Muslim community. So the Muslim should be very careful and should have Muslim, trusted Muslim, honest Muslim who will be in the leadership, who's the one who have the decision to benefit and take care of the Muslim community. No one can benefit or hurt except with the permission of Allah. We already talked about this many times, and we said, just refer to the hadith of Ibn Abbas, radiallahu anhu. You remember that we study in the book of the 40 Nawawi hadith, when Ibn Abbas, Abdullah Ibn Abbas, he said that Prophet ﷺ told him that, وَعَلَمْ أَنَّ الْأُمَّةَ لَوْ اجْتَمَعَتْ لَعَلَىٰ أَنْ يَضُرُّكَ بِشَيْءٍ لَمْ يَضُرُّكَ إِلَّا بِشَيْءٍ قَدْ كَتَبُهُ اللَّهُ عَلَيْكَ وَلَنْ اجْتَمَعَتْ لَا يَنْفَعُكَ لَيَنْفَعُكَ إِلَّا بِشَيْءٍ كَتَبُهُ أو كما قال صلى الله عليه وسلم. And then know for sure that if the whole people, they get together to hurt you in something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't want to happen to you, it will never happen to you. I'll protect you from it. That side, if the whole world get together to benefit you in any way, and Allah Azza wa Jalla did not permit this, it will not happen. And nobody can benefit you. And you can see now, there are some very famous, rich individual, they have a lot of money. When they get sick, they get doctors, you know, they doctors, experts from all over the world. But they cannot give them cure. Why? Because the cure is with Allah. And the command is with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And as we said, this increase the Muslim trust and reliance in Allah Azza wa Jalla subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then, as we said, all blessing that and favor come from Allah. Therefore, we should be very thankful. My dear brothers, we should give thanks to whatever Allah Azza wa Jalla gave us. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promised in many ayat, لَأَنْ شَكَرْتُمْ لَأَزِدَنَّكُمْ. If you give thanks, you will get more. Allah Azza wa Jalla give you and then just give it. Show appreciation for the blessing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave it to you. When you appreciate the blessing, the ni'mah of Allah, Allah will increase you and give you more blessing. And then we'll go to the next ayah. مَا نَنْسَخْ مِنْ آيَةٍ أَوْ نُنْسِيهَا نَأْتِ بِخَيْرٍ مِنْهَا أَوْ مِثْلِيهَا أَلَمْ تَعْلَمْ أَنَّ اللَّهَ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٍ. The ayah, whatever verse or ayah, as we said, revelation, do we abrogate or cause to be forgotten, we bring better one or similar to it. Know you not that Allah is able to do all things? Whatever ayah do we abrogate? Ayah, you know the ayah, any ayah in the Quran. Abrogate, the meaning of the word abrogate and abrogation is to delete or cancel its effect. Now, and this is what they call it abrogation. And here it said that, or cause forgotten. And this, by the way, there's different explanation for the ulama related this. That may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala take it away. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed certain verses at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and some of these verses already taken away. So it will not be remembered. It's not included in the Quran, but it was there one time. This during the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because as long as the revelation was coming, then it is for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to change, exchange, give, take, because it is that the revelation is still in process. So it has been happened some abrogation in the Quran. And this abrogation, just I would like you to concentrate with me about this, because this is very critical, very important matter. Because some people, they may have said, how come you said that abrogation, that means there's deleting or changing the Quran during the process, as we said, revelation. Okay, this happened in different way. But let's first of all go to the basic rules that we should understand. First of all, no abrogation happened in the news. I mean, whatever stories, whatever history, whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told about in the past, there's no abrogation. Why? Because this is something happened and now you are telling about it. You cannot say it was one time it said it happened and another time no, say it didn't happen. So there's no obligation in the news. This is one. Second, there is no obligation in the foundation of the belief, which is the aqidah. The belief in Allah, angels, all these articles of faith, the basis for the aqidah, for the belief, it was the same from the time of Adam till the time of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. No different. All the prophets, they called to the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All prophets were called to accept other prophets when they come. So, for the articles of faith, there's no obligation, no change. Then, when or where the change could happen? In the rules. Only in ahkam. In ahkam, or what we call it, the law. And the example for this, for example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put very strict law in the Torah for the children of Israel. And then when Allah Azza wa Jalla sent Isa alayhi salam, Jesus Christ, he came to confirm the truth, but also he modified some of the law which was, or rules which was mentioned in the Torah. It was changed. So this is abrogation for rules. When Allah Azza wa Jal sent Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the law which was brought or revealed in the Quran, that's overcome all previous rules and laws which was before. So we don't go back to see what was in the Torah or the Gospel. No, in the Quran, everything. We are not in need to take any rules or law. It's different. So this is a change. This is what they call it, نسخ الشريعة بالشريعة, to abrogate complete law with other law, which is the law of previous prophet with the successor prophet. Inside Islam, after Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم was sent here, also there have been abrogation in the rules at the time of the process of the revelation. And this abrogation in the Quran, it took three forms or three ways. One is to abrogate, that's mean to delete or taken away, the ayah, the verse itself, so it's not to be found in the Quran, and the law. Like, for example, as mentioned by Aisha radiallahu anha, she said, it was before, there is one verse that said that when the baby suckled for 10, nursed for 10 times, then this what called, you see, give him, it's like brother in nursing or something like this. This is what they call it, nursery. By milk, by you know, feeding, breastfeeding for the baby, this it was 10 times to make this strange baby become one of the family, so that lady who fed him, she will be his mother, because she feed him through nursing him with her milk, and her husband will be her his father. In this, you know, regard, and this will apply to the rest, a relation with the rest of the family. So this, it was 10 times, and it was mentioned, but all this was taken. The verse itself and the rules itself, because the rules now, it's become later on to 5 times, only 5 times. The second type is the abrogation of what? Of the abrogation or the of the verse, but the rules still exist. I mean, continue. Like, for example, stoning the one who commit adultery. Umar radiallahu anhu ibn al-Khattab, he said, we used to read in the Quran that the old man or woman who commit zina, they should be stoned to death. It was an ayah, it was a verse. But then ayah was taken away, but the rules now still was not abrogated. So the law continued. The abrogation also has come another way, that the rules will be removed, either taken or deleted or maybe change, and the verse is still there. As an example for this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the Surah Al-Mujadala, that when, just to give you the meaning of the ayah, the translation for the meaning of the ayah, when you want to have private counseling with the Prophet, then before you do this, you should give a surety, give away a surety. So when this ayah was revealed, Ali radiallahu anhu, he came to want to consult the Prophet privately. So he gave charity and then he made consent. Right after this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala removed this law. And Allah Azza wa Jalla said, the next ayah, أَأَشْفَقْتُمْ أَن تُقَدِّمُوا بَيْنَ يَدَيْنَا نَجْوَاكُمْ صَدَقَاتٍ. You feel sorry that you give surety or found it difficult for you, Allah forgive you, no need for this. Ah, is there. The first one and the second one. The one said, give, and the one which said, Allah forgive you, no need to give anymore. This is the type of, that was time in a way of replacement. Like, for example, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Muslim, they used to pray to Bayt al-Maqdis, to Al-Quds, Jerusalem. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the Quran that he should direct to Mecca instead of Palestine, or instead to Al-Quds. Also, like, for example, now, maybe some people, they argue, they said, you see, the Quran said, don't approach or, you know, or pray while you are drunk. And then I will say to you, so it's okay to drink, but not at the time of salah. This ayah also was abrogated, which means the rules were deleted with what? With another ayah that come later, which said, إِنَّمَا الْأَنْصَابُ وَالْأَزْلَامُ وَالرِّجْلَ. And then which talk about khamr and alcohol and drugs as it is forbidden completely, not only at the time of salah. So, but still we read the ayah which came before, which said it is limited to the time of what? Of prayer. These different types, you know, obligation to show you that the kingdom is for Allah. The one who legislates and has the right to make something lawful or forbidden is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then someone may ask, okay, what the wisdom behind this? Allah tests people by this. Tested them by giving them a law and see who will respond. And then Allah Azza wa Jal changed it. As it's happened in, and this is why, you know, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to turn from Bayt al-Maqdis to Mecca for Qibla, some of the people, they left Islam. Subhanallah. So this is very important to understand that Allah Azza wa Jal is testing people through this way. So I hope that the topic of obligation very, very clear for you. And maybe inshallah we'll send you something to the group. Just remind me at our admin, and we'll send an article in detail about this point. Now, Allah Azza wa Jal said, will you bring better or one similar to it? When Allah Azza wa Jal changed something, he changed it for wisdom and may change it for something which is better. Better for the people, better. Like, for example, at the beginning of Islam, when Allah Azza wa Jal commanded the Muslim to fast, so they fast, they break their fast at Maghrib, and then they can eat and drink and enjoy their breakfast till they either sleep or pray Isha. If anyone after Maghrib he slept, then when he wake up, he will be wake up as a fasting. So he will not eat anything. The same thing, when the time of Isha come, this is the end. So they resume fasting. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala read in Surah Al-Baqarah, أُحِلَّ لَكُمْ لَيْلَةَ الصِّيَامِ الرَّفَثُ إِلَىٰ نِسَائِكُمْ. And then Allah Azza wa Jalla said, you can eat and drink and have relation till dawn, till the Fajr. And this is to show you the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which it was limited to time between Maghrib and Isha, and now the whole night the Muslim, you know, is not fasting. So what Allah Azza wa Jalla, when he replaced something, he replaced it for hikmah, or maybe give something which is better or at least similar. Na'am. Know you not that Allah is able to do all things? This is the purpose here. For the person to remember that whatever command come from Allah, you have no choice but what? To say, we hear and we obey. No argument. سَمِعْنَا وَاطَعْنَا. No argument with this. Because the command is for Allah. Allah is the creator. And Allah is the one who gives the law. Nobody can change the law of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or the rules of Allah azza wa jal. Confirming the abrogation of the Quran, as we explained in different way, the replacement is better from that what was removed, because as we said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is merciful. So when he changed something, he changed it for our goodness. Even some people, they may not realize or comprehend the wisdom behind it. Confirming the greatness and wisdom of Allah in legislating whatever is best. So one of the wisdom of Allah Azza wa Jal in this, when he legislate certain rules, he legislated gradually, as what's happened with the drugs, with the alcohol. You know, because at the time with the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, the Arabs were heavy drunkards at that time. You know, the alcohol is everything in their life. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the prohibition of alcohol in different step. First of all, they said, they asked regarding alcohol, said, there is something, it is good, it is bad, but there is something good in it. Okay. Preparing them to accept what comes next. And they said, don't pray or come to prayer while you are drunk. So now, part of the time, you should be awake, which is the time of Salah, which is five times. And then come the last step, and it said, stop, and it's not lawful to consume this. So this is one example of the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah put people in trial, as we said, and test them, and they respond to his commands. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded them, as we read, you know, in the previous ayat, when we talk about the children of Israel, and also in this ummah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put the people in trials. Like when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned about those who are in ihram, the state of ihram, they should not, it's not lawful for them, the land animal hunting. It was said that some or those who are in the state of ihram, they were traveling to Mecca, and these hunts has come very close to them, that even the person, he can catch it with his hand. Why? Allah sent it to them to test them. Are they going to respond, control their desire, apply? So sometimes, as we mentioned in previous lesson, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it available in front of you to violate the law or the rules just to test you. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. The promise of Allah that any abrogation will be replaced with something which is better. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the next ayah, know you not that it is Allah to whom belongs the dominion of the heavens and the earth, and beside Allah you have neither anybody, no protector or guardian, nor any helper. This ayat came after Allah Azza wa Jalla talk about the law, and he is the one that could be considered the lawgiver. He is the only lawgiver. Nobody had the right to make and accept Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then said, know you not that it is Allah to whom belongs, since everything is belong to Allah. And he is the one who has the authority. And this creation is his. Therefore, it is very reasonable matter that he is the one who will put the rules. And for instance, now some people, you know, they accept from any company, any country, any embassy, any job, to their rules and their conditions. Every time now, if you want to use an application or you want to apply to any activity, they will tell you to sign or to click that you accept the rules and the condition. You're asking, why you are putting these conditions for using this credit card or doing this? They say, no, we are the one who own it, therefore we have the right to put the law. Subhanallah. So whatever in this world is belong to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he is the one who gives the laws, and he has the right. Nobody else other than him has the right to legislate for the people, because everything is belonging to him, and he has control over whatever exists. And don't think there is anybody beside. This is confirming Tawheed here. And beside Allah, you have neither any wali, no protector, no guardian. Nobody will help beside Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is a warning against shirk for those who go and supplicate the dead, saint, as they call them, or what they call them, wali. There's no wali except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Nobody will help you beside him. And this too is warning for those who follow these ways, which is far from Tawheed. Confirming the fact that everything is owned by Allah Azza wa Jal and belong to him. And the kingdom of the heaven and earth belongs to Allah Azza wa Jal. So he can do whatever he wants, because this, as we said, it is his kingdom, and no one can save anyone from Allah's decree. No one. So if you want something, ask Allah Azza wa Jalla for. If you want protection, ask Allah to protect you. No one. Don't go to grave and ask the same person to intermediate for you, because he will not benefit you. In fact, this dead person is in need for your dua. You are in a better situation. You're still alive and you have chance to ask Allah Azza wa Jalla. But he is dead. He's already gone. But because, unfortunately, some people, they don't understand the Quran, they don't study the Quran, and they just imitate people in their community, they follow this deviation. Allah Azza wa Jalla protect us all from this. And we'll stop, inshallah, here. We'll continue for ayah 108 next week, because it has mashallah some detail. I don't like to start with it and then we stop, otherwise it would take us longer than the time for our class. Jazakum Allah khair. May Allah reward you for joining this class. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala benefit us from whatever we do, and whatever we say and make, whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us عز وجل سبحانه وتعالى in our increase us in our health, increase us in our knowledge, and may Allah سبحانه وتعالى bless whatever knowledge that we got and help us to practice whatever we learn. جزاكم الله خير بارك الله فيكم. See you إن شاء الله next week at 1:15, because as we said, the time for the salah, it's hard to start before this time. The salah still will come out from the masjid around 5 minutes after one. And this is what I expect, because I didn't see many people come till after 1:15. Jazakum Allah khair. Any questions? Yes. If there are no questions, then I will stop here. Barakallahu feekum. Okay, so then see you inshallah next week. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.